morning. Maybe it was that you were getting up for church and your spouse didn't. Oh, I'm not going to look at the new one, but that's okay. That was written in here before you said it. Maybe it's that as you were getting ready for church this morning, the kids didn't cooperate with you. They didn't want to wear what you wanted to wear. They didn't want to have to go to church. It's too boring. Run. Maybe on the way into church this morning, how many ran into frustrated from time to time? And we wonder all these things. Sometimes it may be frustration at work. Maybe the boss yells at you for something that you didn't do. Makes you feel like you're not adequate. Maybe it's at home or at play or even in the church. Perhaps you come to church and someone's sitting in your seat. Man, that is the worst. Frustration can happen at all kinds of levels. There can be a collective frustration. That's when everyone together is upset. You know, I'm a sports fan, and growing up in Michigan, I've always been a fan of the Detroit Tigers. I love the Tigers, and the Tigers, I remember probably the earliest sports memory I have is the 1968 World Series Tigers, being excited about the Tigers winning. I was in college when they won the World Series in 1984 in Ann Arbor, and we celebrated. It was a great thing. But since then, I feel like I should be a Cubs fan, at least until last year. Because every time they come up, they get you so close, and then they lose, and I just get, and this year, forget about it. They're awful. But it's not just the Tigers that make me upset. You know my favorite sports team. What? The University of Michigan Wolverines. I am a Michigan Wolverine, the great team. I love them. I live and die with them, and every game is important. But there's one game a year that is far more important than all others in Michigan. It's not Iowa. At the end of the season every year, there is one of the greatest rivalries. Last year, we were ahead until the last play. Now, I do, just as a side note, we still own a 10-game lead overall in history, and I'll hold on. Just ask those who didn't win the presidential election last November. Frustration can be collective. Frustration can also be individual. Golf has to be the devil's favorite sport. Because most people think that the purpose of golf is to hit the ball into the hole. But the devil has convinced us the purpose of golf is to get a hole-in-one in every shot. And anything less than a hole-in-one in every shot, you're left disappointed. Let me give you a perfect 10th hole. And it's the hole isn't very long. It's like 325 yards. And about 260 yards out, there's a big creek that crosses in front of the hole. Most of the time, you hit your first shot short of that and try to hit it on the green. And then there's a narrow, narrow opening that you can hit through if you hit between trees that you can hit to the green. I hit my shot to the left, and Bill hits it down the middle. Dusty got it. No, he's right there with the baby. He's pretending it's heaven. He hits an amazing shot. It traveled like 324 and a half yards, right down the wood, over the water, bounced in front of the green, rolled up, got up off the cart, and both Dusty and I walked up to the ball 8 inches off the green. You're supposed to be there 2 shots. He almost makes it 1, and you and I had the exact same thought. If I'd only hit it a little bit further. Right? We said that to each other. Golf is frustrating. It is by nature frustrating. In fact, Mark Twain said, quoted golf as a good walk spoiled. It tears at our hearts. Frustration can mount up within us to the point that we feel like maybe we don't deserve to be loved. Maybe no one can love someone who's like me. No one can forgive me for my past transgressions. This is the kind of frustration that St. Paul was talking about in the second lesson for today. This is the kind of frustration that we heard spoke of in our lesson. If you remember those words, Paul was angry. He was mad. He was frustrated, not at the church, not at the Roman Christians, not even at God. His anger, his frustration was turned inward. He was mad at himself. He starts out in verse 15 by saying something that all of us can identify with. I don't understand what I do. What I do is not what I want. What I hate, that's what I do. How many of I promised myself I'm not going to stop at Casey's and get donuts anymore. No, I'll tell you, that's actually happening. I'm going to stop using that language at work, at home, and then it comes out. I'm going to read my Bible every day, in the morning when I wake up, and then we forget. We choose not to. How many of us have been frustrated over the desire to do the right thing and then a failure at it? How many of us have been frustrated over a desire to stop a bad habit that just keeps going on and on? Am I the only one? All of us know right from wrong. We know what we're supposed to do. Almost all of us have either been through confirmation or Sunday school. We've heard the Ten Commandments. We know what God's law is for us. We know what His desire is for us. We know He doesn't want us to do certain things, and yet there we are, doing them just like we know we shouldn't. We know we're not supposed to offend our parents and make them angry, but see, it seems to happen over and over again. We know we're not supposed to tell a lie, but when that moment of truth comes, we turn the other direction. We know we're not supposed to cheat or steal or commit sexual sins, and yet we find ourselves involved in those activities. We know God doesn't want us to have other gods, and certainly we wouldn't worship Buddha, but we have no problem worshiping money or sports, family. We know what we're supposed to do, but we do not do it. I can sympathize with Paul. I've been there, and I would dare say all of us have. Angry and frustrated with Christ, a man who was confronted and converted by God Himself on the road to Damascus. Paul, who was with Barnabas and Timothy and Silas to share the gospel all over the Middle East, who wrote 13 books included in our New Testament. This was a great man of faith, somebody who for his faith was shipwrecked, imprisoned, persecuted, beaten, all because he preached the word of God. If a man who was strong in God's faith like Paul can say, I don't understand what I do, what chance do we have? What hope do we have to somehow do things differently? Just a few minutes ago, we had an amazing privilege of witnessing two young children come into the family of God through baptism. In baptism, our old sinful self, all of our sins, let me repeat this, all of your sins, all of our sins are forgiven and forgotten by God through baptism. From baptism, we also are connected not just with the forgiveness, but with the resurrection of the Father, with Christ. By grace, our life is now dedicated to God, and we should live a grateful and thankful life all the days of our life in response to everything that God has given us in our baptism. We should live the straight and narrow and always do what we're supposed to do and never do what we're not. What's the problem? How come we don't? With all due respect to our newest brothers and sisters in Christ, they're not going to be good. Sorry, parents. And neither are you, by the way, or your grandparents or anyone else. Why can't we be better? St. Paul continues in his letter to Romans with these words. For I have the desire to do what's good, but I can't carry it out. For I do not do the good that I want to do. If we're Jewish, we might throw up our hands and say, Lord, wait! What am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to live? How can I get along? But Paul then gives us some insight as to what's going on in the next passages. He knows what's happening. He says, in reality, there are two forces that are waging war in our lives. Kind of like that little illustration of the two little guys sitting on your shoulders. You got the devil on one and the angel on the other. And the devil's whispering in your ear saying, go ahead. In this past week, how many have been frustrated at one time or another? My pastor's hand was the first one to go up. Well, how many have been frustrated in just this last morning? Maybe it was that you were getting up for church and your spouse didn't. Oh, I'm not going to look at the new one, but that's okay. That was written in here before you said that. Maybe it's that as you were getting ready for church this morning, the kids didn't cooperate with you. They didn't want to wear what you wanted them to wear. They didn't want to have to go to church. It's too boring. Run. Maybe on the way into church this morning, how many ran into frustrated from time to time? And we wonder all these things. Sometimes it may be frustration at work. Maybe the boss yells at you for something that you didn't do. Makes you feel like you're not adequate. Maybe it's at home or at play or even in the church. Perhaps you come to church and someone's sitting in your seat. Man, that is the worst. Frustration can happen at all kinds of levels. There can be a collective frustration. That's when everyone together is upset. You know, I'm a sports fan, and growing up in Michigan, I've always been a fan of the Detroit Tigers. I love the Tigers, and the Tigers, I remember probably the earliest sports memory I have is the 1968 World Series Tigers, being excited about the Tigers winning. I was in college when they won the World Series in 1984 in Ann Arbor, and we celebrated. It was a great thing. But since then, I feel like I should be a Cubs fan, at least until last year. Because every time they come up, they get you so close, and then they lose, and I just get, and this year, forget about it. They're awful. But it's not just the Tigers that make me upset. You know my favorite sports team, what? The University of Michigan Wolverines. I am a Michigan Wolverine, the great team. I love them. I live and die with them, and every game is important. But there's one game a year that is far more important than all others in Michigan. It's not Iowa. At the end of the season every year, there is one of the greatest rivalries. Last year, we were ahead until the last play. Now, I do, just as a side note, we still own a 10-game lead overall in history, and I'll hold on. Just ask those who didn't win the presidential election last November. Frustration can be collective. Frustration can also be individual. Golf has to be the devil's favorite sport. Because most people think that the purpose of golf is to hit the ball into the hole. But the devil has convinced us the purpose of golf is to get a hole-in-one in every shot. And anything less than a hole-in-one in every shot, you're left disappointed. Let me give you a perfect 10th hole. And it's the hole isn't very long. It's like 325 yards. And about 260 yards out, there's a big creek that crosses in front of the hole. Most of the time, you hit your first shot short of that and try to hit it on the green. And then there's a narrow, narrow opening that you can hit through if you hit between trees that you can hit to the green. I hit my shot to the left, and Bill hits it down the middle. Dusty got it. No, he's right there with the baby. He's pretending it's heaven. He hits an amazing shot. It traveled like 324 and a half yards, right down the wood, over the water, bounced in front of the green, rolled up, got up off the cart, and both Dusty and I walked up to the ball 8 inches off the green. You're supposed to be there two shots. He almost makes it one, and you and I had the exact same thought. If I'd only hit it a little bit further. Right? We said that to each other. Golf is frustrating. It is by nature frustrating. In fact, Mark Twain said, quoted golf as a good walk spoiled. It tears at our hearts. Frustration can mount up within us to the point that we feel like maybe we don't deserve to be loved. Maybe no one can love someone who's like me. No one can forgive me for my past transgressions. This is the kind of frustration that St. Paul was talking about in the second lesson for today. This is the kind of frustration that we heard spoke of in our lesson. If you remember those words, Paul was angry. He was mad. He was frustrated, not at the church, not at the Roman Christians, not even at God. His anger, his frustration was turned inward. He was mad at himself. He starts out in verse 15 by saying something that all of us can identify with. I don't understand what I do. What I do is not what I want. What I hate, that's what I do. How many of you? I promised myself I'm not going to stop at Casey's and get donuts anymore. No, I'll tell you, that's actually happening. I'm going to stop using that language at work, at home, and then it comes out. I'm going to read my Bible every day, in the morning when I wake up, and then we forget. We choose not to. How many of us have been frustrated over the desire to do the right thing and then a failure at it? How many of us have been frustrated over the desire to stop a bad habit that just keeps going on and on? Am I the only one? All of us know right from wrong. We know what we're supposed to do. Almost all of us have either been through confirmation or Sunday school. We've heard the Ten Commandments. We know what God's law is for us. We know what His desire is for us. We know He doesn't want us to do certain things, and yet there we are, doing them just like we know we shouldn't. We know we're not supposed to offend our parents and make them angry, but see, it seems to happen over and over again. We know we're not supposed to tell a lie, but when that moment of truth comes, we turn the other direction. We know we're not supposed to cheat or steal or commit sexual sins, and yet we find ourselves involved in those activities. We know God doesn't want us to have other gods, and certainly we wouldn't worship Buddha, but we have no problem worshiping money, or sports, or family. We know what we're supposed to do, but we do not do it. I can sympathize with Paul. I've been there, and I would dare say all of us have. Angry and frustrated, despised. A man who was confronted and converted by God Himself on the road to Damascus. Paul, who was with Barnabas and Timothy and Silas to share the gospel all over the Middle East, who wrote 13 books included in our New Testament. This was a great man of faith, somebody who for his faith was shipwrecked, imprisoned, persecuted, beaten, all because he preached the word of God. If a man who was strong in God's faith, like Paul, can say, I don't understand what I do, what chance do we have? What hope do we have to somehow do things differently? Just a few minutes ago, we had an amazing privilege of witnessing two young children come into the family of God through baptism. In baptism, our old sinful self, all of our sins, let me repeat this, all of your sins, all of our sins are forgiven and forgotten by God through baptism. From baptism, we also are connected not just with the forgiveness, but with the resurrection of the Father, with Christ. By grace, our life is now dedicated to God, and we should live a grateful and thankful life all the days of our life in response to everything that God has given us in our baptism. We should live the straight and narrow and always do what we're supposed to do and never do what we're not. What's the problem? How come we don't? With all due respect to our newest brothers and sisters in Christ, they're not going to be good. Sorry, parents. And neither are you, by the way, or your grandparents or anyone else. Why can't we be better? St. Paul continues in his letter to Romans with these words. For I have the desire to do what's good, but I can't carry it out. For I do not do the good that I want to do. If we're Jewish, we might throw up our hands and say, oh, boy, what am I supposed to do? How am I supposed to live? How can I get along? But Paul then gives us some insight as to what's going on in the next passages. He knows what's happening. He says, in reality, there are two forces that are waging war in our lives. Kind of like that little illustration of the two little guys sitting on your shoulders. You got the devil on one and the angel.